streets of gold, or to hear the angels sing? Is it just to drink from that fountain that never shall run dry?
Turn from their wicked ways. Good morning and happy Shabbat to you, my friends, my loved ones, and brothers and sisters in Christ. It's nice to see a beautiful morning here after quite a few gloomy days because of the lockdown, but it's good. It all depends on our attitude. Whether it's raining, cloudy or what, we should always be thankful, especially when we wake up in the morning. It's a miracle to wake up. Some people, they go to sleep, and I know some people, even friends of mine, who passed, they went to sleep, and they were expecting to be awake the following day. They had plans what to do the following day, but they never woke up. So it's really a miracle to wake up every morning. That's why we should always be thankful. And today is a holy Sabbath of the Lord, and if we should even be more thankful, because at least God brings us to this day where we can spend our time for Him, we can think about Him, concentrate on Him and everything. Before we start our program, I would like to invite you for a word of prayer. Father God, thank you so much for waking us up this beautiful morning, to this beautiful Sabbath day. Thank you for the week that you have just added to our lives, and we started a new week again. And of course, we are so thankful that every week has to end with a Sabbath day, because you said that on the Sabbath, we can bring back all our memories of your love, of your creation, for creating us, creating this earth and everything in it, and for giving us life. We're so thankful for that, dear Father. And we know, we have realized that the purpose of our life is to glorify you when we are alive, and because we're going back to you if we stay faithful to you. We ask that you forgive us our sins as we come, as we approach your throne of grace. And this Father, we continue to ask you for your protection to us, especially with this ongoing COVID-19, which is affecting the lives of so many people. Bless those people who are being compromised, but at least before they go, they will hear about you, they will know about you, and they will accept you, your invitation to them to join your camp and for their names to be written in the Book of Life. Dear Father, I pray that you will bless our presentation today, and may it go to the ears of those people who are willing to know about you, and may it penetrate deep into their hearts and their minds, and that they may accept the message from you. We ask now that you will bless this service that we're going to have, even right from our home, but it will reach many people all over the world. So please bring to the screen those people whom you would like to be reached by this program. We ask now all this favor in Jesus' holy name, I pray. Amen. Thank you so much, my friends and loved ones, for giving some time to be able to hear the presentation that we're going to share this morning. I have decided to take this topic of God is at war, and I think it's very timely. You know why we're supposed to give you some live music about 20 minutes earlier here, 9:40 I said. But I think the enemy is not happy with what we're doing here, because since yesterday, since last night, we couldn't connect our internet. There's Wi-Fi, but we cannot get, and the server was not working. And so I said, this morning, even for the last minute, it was not working. So we prayed. I told my wife, come, let us pray, because many people, I think there's someone. See, the battle here in this world is really, the big battle is between supernatural powers. Okay, it's within good and evil, God and Satan. So maybe the enemy is not pleased with people listening. There are so many preachers who are going to preach today, especially it's God's day, God's time. And many people, the enemy does not want those people to hear about the messages today. That's why, I don't know, it might just be us who had problems with the internet, but it might be all over, I don't know about that. But let me just bring you to these messages that I have just a couple of days ago, I saw this. This is from the president of this worldwide movement, Pastor Ted Wilson. He said, time on earth is short, probation is closing soon. Preparation to see God face to face by repentance and forsaking of sin needs to be done. It needs to be done now, okay? And then I also, it needs to be done, and everyone will be given a chance, okay? Everyone will be given a chance to make the final decision whether they should stay with tradition or teaching that they have inherited from whoever, or they will look for God, their creator, okay, who put them into this earth, okay, and look for the truth and accept the truth. That is the decision that everybody has to make. But I was also reading in the book of Daniel. Daniel said, remember when Daniel was having vision, was being given inspiration by God to write of what is going to happen in the end. At the end, or towards the end chapter, the last chapter of Daniel, Daniel said, and he said to Daniel, go your way, Daniel, for the words are closed. At the time, God said, the words are going to be closed now till the time of the end. That's why Daniel was not able to give much information from his book up to the book of Revelation. There's a connection between Daniel and the book of Revelation, okay? And God said, many shall be purified, made white and refined, but the wicked shall do wickedly. The wicked probably will not change, okay? And none of the wicked shall understand, but the wise shall understand, okay? So, the wicked, if you do not understand, if you do not, if this truth does not appeal to you, if the truth does not move your heart, does not move your mind, okay? Maybe you're one of those being described here by God, okay? That you will not understand. And I've given several Bible studies. I have given Bible studies to people who I thought were wise. It was clear to them, the presentation was clear, that it's really true. I read the information from their own Bible, not even my Bible. That's why I even have a Bible here. That isn't a Bible. It's given to me by a Catholic friend. It's a Catholic Bible. But the Bible is the same. And this is what I read mostly when I give a Bible study. So, some people I thought are wise, I read them from their Bible. They accept it, but yet, maybe they do not understand. Because when I ask them to join the army of God, to enlist, as to become one God's children, they refuse, okay? Or they hesitate, and when they hesitate, you know, God said in the Bible that when you hesitate, you put me in shame. And when you put me in shame, sometimes, you know, probation, I was talking about probation the other day. Probation closes different times on different people. Like, those people who are dying because of this COVID-19 or whatever, accidents. I believe, because, you know, no death will happen unless God allows it. Okay, the one who destroys lives of people is the enemy. Okay, of course there's death, supposed to be, our life has a time limit, okay? It has to end, okay? That's why God said, if you live according to my commandments, I will even take sickness away from you. So you live a life that is abundant, that is free of sickness, happy, abundant life, but still you will die. You know why we all die? Because of sin, the curse of sin. The wages of sin is death, okay? That's why when Adam and Eve sinned, God said, you will surely die, and they surely died, OK? okay, their shelf became old, their hair became white, and eventually they died. So everybody has to die because of that sin, because we all committed sin, okay? But the promise of God is that if you enlist, okay, and because of that, because we all committed sin, the book, all the names of people in this world are not in the book of life. You read that in Revelation 13:8. All that dwell on the earth worship the devil, and their names are not written in the book of life. Because our names were all in the book of death, after sin. But because of the love of God, he started commuting with the prophets to write about him, to write about the Messiah coming, and those that obeyed him even before the Messiah came, their names were being transferred to the book of life. Those are the prophets and so on. But then Jesus Christ came, sacrificed his life for us, and he lived like a human being so that we'll understand that even humans can be connected to God while they are living on earth, which is a kingdom of Satan right now after he has conquered this earth through the sinfulness of the one assigned to take care of this earth, which was Adam. So anyway, but God, because of God's love, he sent his only begotten us to redeem us from that eternal death that we inherited because of the sin of our fathers, okay? So we were redeemed from that, okay? We don't have to die eternally anymore, okay? But in order for us to receive that gift of eternal life, no more eternal death, we have to accept Jesus Christ. That is the requirement in the Bible. If you go to Acts, if you want to be saved, only those who accept Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior, accept the teachings of Jesus Christ, accept the steps of Jesus Christ, accept his ways, and follow him, his steps, they are the only ones who, even if they die, supposed to be eternal death, God is going to resurrect them and give them eternal life. It's so beautiful, eternal life. You know, when I realized that, I thought life was so good and so on. When I was younger, I was not worrying about biblical things. But when I have realized that, when I studied about this eternal life, what's so beautiful, it's nice to be alive, okay? No matter what kind of life is it, even if it's hell, it's nice to be alive, okay? Of course, if it's hell, but if you're with God, you know, it will not be like hell to you. No matter what the situation is, you will be able to go through it, okay? So, that is gift. So I do not understand why people, even if they are enlightened about the truth, even if you tell them about the love of God, promise of the eternal life, still their minds are close to it. Okay, and they do not. And I understand when I read this book from Daniel. He said, "I understand because the wicked, they will understand God's word." Okay, that's so that what happened. Blessed is he who waits and comes to 1,000 and comes to him, because they will be given the eternal life and so on. And so everyone will make a final decision, truth or tradition. We will all be faced with that. And this COVID-19, I believe, is one way of waking up people. People are being awakened. So they will have the time. They are asked to stay home and listen to some messages from God. And so that they will not know. They cannot blame God. Nobody will be able to blame God and say, "I did not know about it." Okay? And if you are not searching for the truth, you cannot blame God also. Because I was giving a Bible study to one of the judges here in Canada, a Filipino judge, you know. He has attained the highest position in the court system of Canada at that time, anyway. And so he requested for Bible study. I gave him Bible study. So I told him, I asked him a question. Supposing a Filipino guy is brought to you because he has done something against the law of Canada. And then he pleaded to you, he said, "Honorable judge, I'm sorry that I did such a thing because I did not know about it. I was not informed about it." Okay? So are you going to convict him based on what he has done? He said, "I will." That's what the judge said. I will convict him. Even if he did not know that it was wrong to do that, you will convict him? He said, yes. I asked him why. That's because he is supposed to know. It is assumed that he is supposed to know. He was not forced by Canada to come here. Nobody asked him to come. It was his decision to come. And I'm sure that before he came to Canada, he has to know about Canada. He has to live in that country of Canada. He has to know what the rules are there, what the orders are, what the government is about. He has to know. So he cannot just come here and say he did not know about it, because he will not be a good citizen of Canada. That is the same thing. The truth is being spread. Nowadays, there's a lot that God allowed this to happen so many people can hear the truth. Okay? And we have to, so we cannot be ignorant about it anymore, because it comes to them, comes to you. And so, it is presumed. Like, that's why God is preparing you. Yes, he's giving the truth information, so that people will know, and they cannot go to heaven and be ignorant and say, oh, I did not know that it's wrong to do this. No. Okay? And we cannot go to Jesus and say, where are the nightclubs here? Where are the casinos? I'd like to go to the casino. Because they already know. Okay? So everyone has to make a decision. That's why the Bible says that that when Jesus comes, all eyes will see him. Okay? So some people say that their eyes will be open a little bit, just for them to realize, oh, this is Jesus Christ that was preached to me at that time by Dr. Noel. And I never listened, I never believed him. Somebody told me about it, I never believed him. But it's true. I'm really sorry. So they know that they're not going to get up anymore. So they're going to go back to death. Okay? But for those who believed and accepted Jesus, when they opened their eyes, oh, this is the Jesus that I was waiting for, they will get up. They will be so happy to meet him. While the rest who are not prepared, okay, they will go to the mountains and commit suicide for enough, because we cannot look at the glory of God, okay? So, probation is being closed, as I mentioned. Why do the young people die? Why do babies die? Okay, I'm sure that God make a decision before he allowed them to die, okay? If God knows that the parents are not doing good anyway to rear them, to wake them up, he's not going to teach them about God's eternal salvation that he offers, maybe God will allow them to die, because it's just going to be a problem to society. He knows the future, okay? But if he knows that child will still can be used and will be glorifying him, maybe allow him to live, okay? So it depends on God, or will maybe give the chance to the child to hear about it. But if the parents are not, because said that if the parents are not going to be saved, maybe those small babies will not be allowed to live anymore, okay, to see Jesus when he comes, because what do they use, okay? They have no parent. They have to go up there. So the parents have to try to go to heaven so that their kids can go with them, okay? Because God, who's going to take care of them when they go up there, okay? As they grow up in heaven, so on. That's why if the parents are saved, the babies who have not reached the age of reason yet, okay, where they can understand what is right and wrong, if the parents are saved, the babies are going to go there too, okay? But if the parents are not saved, those babies who did not reach that age of reason, in Bible inspiration, they're not going to be allowed, they're not going to be made to live anymore, okay? Because they did not know what was right and wrong, so what is the purpose? God cannot take them to fire, okay? They did not know, they're innocent, so it's better for them not to live anymore, okay? Now, so remember, before I go on to the subject, I'd like to remind you again, it's very important that we have to follow the orders of the government, of our authorities. Wear a mask when you go out. Wear a mask. Don't go out if possible. But if you go out, wear a mask. You know, because if you're a carrier, at least your breath, or when you cough, your saliva, when you talk to people, will not go to the air and contaminate somebody else. So you're protecting other people, okay? And you are also protecting yourself, because if there's something in the air that tries to hit you, at least it will not go to your mouth or something. And wear gloves, because that virus is very, very tight. Nobody can see it. So if somebody touches the doorknob and he's got a virus there, and you touch it, and you have no gloves, and then you touch yourself again, it will come to you. That's why when you go home, throw the gloves away. Or maybe buy some gloves. Or that's why we are asked to wash, and you wash at least 20 seconds, because within 20 seconds, that virus, it will be studied, that virus will be expelled, or will die with this, the magic of the soap, or the detergent with soap. But if it's less than 20 seconds, it could survive. So let's follow the orders, because it's very important. And if you really want to achieve eternal life, let's listen to God's message, okay? So I'm going to go to the message that we have right now. And where our subject is about God is at work. Okay. God is at work, okay? We are either under God's banner or under the enemy's banner. You'll find that in 2 Corinthians 2:11. Okay? Let me just stand up so at least I can relax my feet a little bit. Sitting down too much is not good, okay? How many of you believe that God loves you? I'm sure we all do, okay? It says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believe in him will not perish but have everlasting life." Okay, and how many of you believe that Jesus loves you? Jesus loves you because so much that for our sake, just to save us, just to prevent us from paying the penalty of sin, that eternal death, what did he do? He died for us. So Jesus loves us. God loves us. The Father loves us. He sent his only begotten Son to die, allow him to sacrifice his Son, in order to give us salvation, give us a life again. And his Son also came and volunteered to give his life, to die, to save us from sin. Is there someone of you who love somebody so much that you're willing to die for them? Okay? It's very hard, it's almost impossible to do what Jesus did. Okay? Die for someone because of love. Okay? To leave that throne in heaven, come down to this earth just to sacrifice his life because of his love. Okay? So Jesus loved us so much that he was willing even to die for his friends. Okay? And all of us are his friends, his disciples and friends. Whenever you are tempted to deny Jesus, okay, remember the cross. Remember that Jesus died for us in the cross, okay? So, if we always remember that, before he died on the cross, you know what he did to his friends? He said, "For a space of 3 years, he spent day and night warning his followers of how his enemy is going to enter the church that he established." He said, "Remember, for 3 years I have been warning you, day and night, with tears," he said, according to Acts 20:28-31. With tears. He warned them that when I depart, when I leave, okay, grievous words will enter this church, will enter this group, this movement that I have started here on earth. They will come, they will enter and introduce teachings that did not come from me. They are here to deceive, okay? So he warned that there will be this deception, okay? So, to save you from that harm and the destruction that the enemy will give, I am warning you now. That's why listen to my words and stay in my words. Paul warned that when Satan enters God's church, there will be falling away from the truth. So, the number one warning of God is to avoid deception. God said that if somebody can take your hand away from you, or cut your hand away, or your feet, whatever, okay, I can always replace that. Or even if you die, I can replace that. But what I cannot replace is your mind, your thinking, okay? So if you allow yourself to be deceived and you accepted wrong teaching, wrong information, and you accepted that, I cannot change that. That is your decision. You made that decision, and because of my love, I allow you to make a decision for yourself. So that's why Jesus said, if you accept that, you are going to die in your sin. Okay? So if you accepted sin and you accepted to be deceived, and you are guilty with people who are trying to teach you the truth, you fight with them, okay, God is going to allow you to keep that in your mind, and you will die in your sin. That's why I mentioned about close of probation, those people who are being compromised even through this coronavirus. God closed their probation on them before he allowed them to go. Because when they go, they cannot change their mind. You know, the teachings of Jesus, when you are dead, no matter how much your friends or relatives pray for you, no matter how much they give, how much money they give to the church or to the priest, it cannot change you. You cannot change anymore, because it is not the priest who decides for you. It is not your parents. It is yourself. You decide for your own destiny. You either build your own monument or you dig your own grave. Okay? Because Satan conquered this earth. He became the emperor of this earth. His teachings will be accepted by those whose names are not written in the book of life. Okay? So, those names, that's why the Bible says, those whose names are not written in the book of life, take them. They will all be bundled, and they will go where the enemy, where Satan and his angels will go, which is the fire that God is preparing for those people who continue to disobey him. And for those who do not disconnect themselves from beliefs, practices, and teachings of this sin, okay, of this, the author of sin, God will send them strong delusion, because they believe that the lie is to be the truthful teachings of God. Many people, if you read the Romans, the people will start to believe that the lie is the truth and the truth is the lie. God promised to destroy this wicked one, these wicked ones, together with all his followers. And I'm talking about Satan with his followers in the fire and brimstone. That you'll find that in Revelation 14, 9 and 10. God is so loving that he gave us free will to choose our destiny. Salvation with Jesus or destruction with his enemy, the devil. That's Matthew 25, 41. Of course, the devil knows that no one in his right mind will choose destruction. That is why he will not teach destruction. He will use God's Bible and teachings in a way that people will be deceived and unknowingly obey his deceptive lies instead of God's truthful teachings. See, Satan is so wise also. He's not going to tell you that if you obey me, you're going to go to destruction. He's not going to tell you that, okay? He tells you that he even promised eternal life also. That is why Satan promises that, don't worry, you do what you want, because when you die, you're going to continue to live, okay? Your body will be left here, and you're going up to God to report to him, because your soul will never die, okay? Whereas, if you read the Bible many times said that the soul that sinned, it will die, okay? All the souls that died in the sea will all come out of the sea, okay? They will float. That's why even now, they're floating, like when Jesus comes, they all float out of the sea. Those are not found. But even now, when somebody drowns, you see some murder story, you read some murder stories, somebody killed somebody and throw them in the ocean, and even sometimes with big weight to go under, eventually that body comes out, okay? So to reveal, so that people can investigate, okay? Satan teaches that if you're alive, if you die, you'll still be alive, because you go to heaven. If people are alive after they die, and all the murder cases in this world can be solved. Why? Because if somebody killed me, I know who killed me, I can, or if the people are looking for my body, I can tell the detectives, or, okay, then my body is there, go there, you'll find it, okay? And so on. So, that's why, you know, it's just like, you know, when somebody is trying to deceive you, he will not do something that you will know it's a deception, okay? If somebody were to give you a $15 bill, that is fake. Would you know that it is fake? Of course you will know that it's fake. Why? Because there is no $15 bill. Okay? It goes in 20s, 50s, and so on. So the person who's going to deceive is not going to give you a $15 fake bill. Okay? But if somebody give you a $20 bill that is fake, would you know? You might not know. You know, those people who are arresting or catching those people who circulate fake money, you know what they do? They do not study about the fake, they study the genuine money, they study it very well to know even how it, even by feeling it, they will know it's fake, okay? So that when something, they touch something that is not, that is fake, they already know, even without examining it, because they already know even by feeling, because they study the genuine money very well. If you would like to go to heaven, you have to study the teachings of Jesus Christ, okay, and compare it with the teaching that you have acquired and the teaching that you are being taught, so that you can, you will know. And the comparison and the test is only this one. God's word is the only test, okay? So if you do that, and you know that this person teaching you has deceived you, next time he come to you, or you tell him anymore, don't see me anymore, please do not come to me anymore, okay? Because you taught me something that is not in the Bible. You deceive me already with one teaching, you're going to deceive me with more. Because one lie will lead to more and more lies. That's why people who tell you that Jesus Christ is not the Messiah, is not the Savior, you be careful with them, okay? Because they are not telling you the truth according to the Bible, unless you do not believe the Bible. So if you do not believe the Bible, which book would you believe? Maybe the Da Vinci book, or somebody written by your friend, or some humans also, who the Bible was much older than, or somebody's opinion in a coffee shop. Is that what you're going to believe? Satan has a counterfeit teaching. Satan has a counterfeit teaching in almost every genuine teachings of Jesus. Satan also has a counterfeit teaching. Example, God teaches love. Satan teaches lust. Okay? And you will not know what the difference is unless you read the Bible, because if you're in love, you feel the same thing. Okay? You always want to see that person that you're lusting for. When you look up in the ceiling, you see her face. Okay, if you're a man, or his face, if you're a woman. When you look at to wash your face, you see a face in the water, and you feel you're missing that person so much if you don't see that person. Okay? So you think it's love. Okay? But if you do not know the Bible, you will know if it's love. Or if it's lust, okay, you will also know. Okay, I won't even have to go into that, because you will know, okay, that if it's love or lust. Satan teaches, God teaches eternal life, Satan teaches eternal life also. When you die, you continue to live in the form of spirit or in the form of something, okay? Whereas Jesus said, if this fruit, you will surely die, okay? And what did Satan say? No, you will not surely die. Eat it, and you become wise. You will think like God, and so on. So on. That's why a lot of teaching come that are not from God. Unless we really search and study the Bible, accept it as God's word, we will stop interpreting the Bible to suit it according to our wants and desires. And unless we really love God with all our hearts and minds, more than anything else, we could end up accepting Satan's lies and deceptive teachings. Okay, that's what will happen. But Revelation 14, 6 to 11 strongly warns, for those who do not come out of false teachings, listen to this, for those who do not come out of false teachings, those who worship the beast, you see, the problem, the battle, the war is between God, the Creator, and the beast, which is the creature. Okay? The creature, you know, because his enemy Satan is somebody that he created also, okay? But to turn away from him. You know, some people ask, well, why did God create a devil, okay? Why did he create a devil who will fight against him? Okay, ask yourself a question. You have children. You teach your children good things. You have good hopes for your children. You wish good things for them. You provide for them. In the middle of the night, you wake up because the child cries, okay? He throws some, when he throws his feces or he throws dirt, you pick them up, okay? And sometimes he plays, he slaps you, he hits you, you don't get angry because it's your child, okay? So you show so much love to the child, you teach him all good things, but when he grows big, what happens? Sometimes they rebel to you because they would like to do what they wanted to do, and you warn them about it, they don't like to be warned, they listen to their friends or peers instead than you. And so what happens? If it goes to the point where you cannot talk to them anymore, they decide to be your enemy. They fight with you. Some children will even might even tell you, "You don't have to tell me, you're not my dad anymore, I'm already old enough, okay? I can do what I want, I don't want to listen to you anymore." See, a child could tell you that. This is what happened to Satan. He was created by God. God took care of him in heaven, everything. He even gave him a very good position to be the head of the angels up there. But what did he do? It was not enough for him. He got jealous. He got angry at God. That's why he became his number one enemy. So that's why God is going to destroy him. He promised to destroy him together with those who followed him. And then he said that one day, which is probably soon, because this epidemic that is happening now, are already signs that it's coming soon. These are signs that Jesus is going to come soon. He's going to put, that's why the Bible says that everyone will be marked in their heads and in their hands. Okay? Now, it's not something like a mark will come out of your head, just like the former president of Russia, which is Khrushchev, which got a mark on the head. No, nothing like that. Okay? The head is a symbol of your mind, a symbol of your thinking, what you believe in, symbol of your thoughts. Okay? And the hand is a symbol of works. So, if you have accepted teachings that came from the enemy, okay, of God, that it will be the practice of your life. That is what your work, that will come out of your work, your practice, okay? So, if your mind accepted the teaching that you should steal, that you should go to the casino and make a lot of money, that you should do whatever, okay? Of course, that is what you're going to do. That will be the result of your work. So whatever is the... But if you decide, your mind accepted the teachings of God, that is also what will come out of your work, of your practices. But in the end, when he closes the probation, he will see that, okay? He will say, Revelation 13, 6 or 17, okay? And he will cause rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their hand and in their foreheads, that no man may buy or sell, save he that has the mark of the beast, okay? So, you know, I was listening to the interview of Pastor Finley the other day, okay? Pastor Finley was being invited by these people who are organizing the different beliefs, different world religions who are organizing to make only a unity of all the religions of the world, all the different groups of people in the world, in order to talk about climate change, which is very good, about climate change, about the environment, okay? It's a very good subject, okay? You know, if I did not know what the purpose is, I would go right away, okay? But Pastor Finley refused to, said, okay, you know, we already know, we conserve, we protect the environment. We believe in environment. That's why we teach. We do not even eat the scavengers, because the scavengers are animals that are created by God to clean the earth. Okay? So we believe that this preservation of the environment, because if we do not kill them and eat them, we will have so many cleaners. This world will not be as sickly as it is or as dirty as it is, because there will be so many cleaners. We do not support those people who are destroying trees and whatever, okay, to destroy the environment. We believe that. But because Mark Finley reads the Bible, you know what I said? But I already know where this is going to, okay? We're going to talk about this collaboration of unity of different beliefs. We're going to talk about the environment, yes, okay? Which is good, okay? And then in order for God not to allow all this destruction, these disasters in this world, is that, or in this earth, we should all be together and we should unite together in worshiping God. Maybe we should just elect one representative to talk to God in heaven, okay? Maybe they'll do that, okay? I don't know if they'll do that. I don't know, okay? But that is the purpose. That is what the Bible teaches. And also, but after that agreement is done, there'll be more disasters that will come. Because the Bible says there'll be more disasters that will come. Who knows? I hope it's not going to be worse than this coronavirus. But it's probably going to be worse, okay? And he said, but the thing is that not every there's a group of people who will not probably agree with the collaboration. And these are the children of God who are following, who are already observing the environment. They're doing the things from God. They will become the enemy because they will be blamed. See, we already unified to talk to God in uniform, but there's this group of people who are not joining us. So the children of God will be the enemy, okay? And if you are a God believer, you'll be the enemy, okay? You know why we'll be the enemy? Because we will not go along with some of the things that they will agree on, okay? And they will agree on worship, which is the number one why they are fighting. You know, like God wants to be worshipped himself, Satan wants to be worshipped. It's a matter of worship. I'll talk to that about that soon. In Galatians 1:8, she says that even if an angel comes down to teach us, we have to test the teachings if it is in the Bible. If it's not in the Bible, we should tell that angel to go away. Because, tell them, okay, oh, you're teaching something, the angel come to you, this is what God said. Okay, where in the Bible can I find it, Mr. Angel? Okay, if you cannot find it to stand in the Bible, of course, you don't just read one text. Because some people, they read one text and they say, that's it now. No. And if you cannot really prove it in the Bible, you should tell the angel, you better go away, leave right now, because you're not an angel of God. You are an angel of Satan. If I do not go away, I'm going to call Jesus, okay? The Bible says that we must not be ignorant of the devil's devices. God has disciples who teach the Bible, and Satan has disciples also who teach the Bible. The difference is that God's enemies twist the truth. If we do not know the genuine, truthful teachings of God, we could not accept the twisted teachings. Like the counterfeit money. Just like the counterfeit money. If you do not study the genuine money, you might not be able to detect what the counterfeit money is. Okay? God warns over and over of accepting the truth and discarding falsehood or deception or tradition. Okay? Every teaching must be tested. If they teach not according to what God teaches, God does not make mistakes and does not change. That's in Isaiah 48. God is not a changeable God. It is because there is no light in those people. That's why they do not teach the truth. If we do not study, we might receive the mark of the beast. That's what God said. If we do not study, we might receive the mark of the beast because we might accept the enemy's teachings instead. If we receive the mark of the beast, the identification of the enemy's mark, we will have the same destiny as God's enemy. Matthew 25:41. So the question that I would like to ask you in this great battle. See, I do not believe that there's going to be a battle like people talk about, like the big battle between the U.S. and China, or U.S. or Russia, and all the people of the world will be annihilated. I don't believe it's going to be like that. Because if it's going to be like that, and all the people of the earth will be sacrificed, will die, then who will Jesus come? Who will Jesus see when he comes? Because the Bible is very clear that when he comes, there will be people who will be alive. Okay? So the battle that people are talking about, the last battle, is not a world war. It's a battle of the minds. Battle of minds. I told you, the people of God will be in one camp, and the people of the enemy will be another camp. Okay? That will be the battle. It will be a battle of beliefs, battle of the mind. And the people of the enemy will be collaborated to try to destroy the people of God. But as they destroy that, you know, there are many laws that will come soon. You watch for it, okay? Because it will probably start with collaboration and everything, and then fighting against the people of God, okay? But God promised that for those who are faithful to Him, He's going to take care of them, okay? Now, in which two separate issues is the fight going to be, okay? This is the big, you know, the battle is based on worship, okay? God said, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. This is a command of the Creator of heavens and earth, remember? And all that in them is. God is the authority of the whole universe, okay? That's why He said, remember the Sabbath day. I'm the Creator of everything, heaven and earth. Exodus 28 to 11. God is the Lord of the Sabbath. You'll find that in Mark 2, 28 and Matthew 12, 8. So Sabbath worship, worshiping on the Sabbath day, today, on Saturday, is the mark of the authority of God. That is the mark of the authority of God. If you would like to know what is the seal, what is the mark of the authority of God, it is the Sabbath worship. Like this money, you know why the money becomes useful, like why it's so powerful that it has power to for another person to give you whatever you want if you give him the exact amount, value according to the money that you give him. That money is just a piece of paper. But you know what makes it valuable? It's the because of the signature of the authority. In the money, you will see there the territory. Okay? The United States of America. You will see there who authorized that money to be useful. Maybe the president with the signature. And then, okay, and the authority, it is mentioned there what his position is, president of the United States. So maybe Donald Trump, okay, president of the United States, and the territory is United States, okay, if he makes money from of his own or during his term, okay? So in the commandment of God, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. It is a seal of God. His authority is that. Why? He said, I am the Lord your God. I created the heaven and the earth. He said, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do thy work. But the seventh day, the Sabbath of the Lord your God. So the Lord is our God. In it you shall not do any work. Thou, nor thy son, nor thy daughter, nor thy stranger, nor thy manservant, maidservant, or animals within your gate, you shall not let them work. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, so that's His territory. He made heaven and earth, the sea and all that in them is, and rested the seventh day, and hallowed it. So He rested, hallowed it, and blessed it, made it holy. So therefore He said, you remember to do that, okay? So that is the authority. What is the authority of another power, okay? Given the power by virtue of divine mission to change God's Sabbath to Sunday worship. He changed time, abrogate laws, dispense with things, even the presence of Christ, okay? There's a reference on that. This is public information, so I'm not just making it up. The Scriptural of Transatlantic Episcopal Convert to Catechism of Catholic Doctrine page. Sunday is our mark of authority. That's what he said, okay? Our church is above the Bible, and the transfer of Sabbath is a proof. That's according to Catholic Record, London. And you okay? Great is the power and authority of our church to take out one of the ten. Okay? That's in, also there. Have we not such power, all the others would not have followed and agreed with the change of the seventh to the first day. We have no scriptural authority. That authority did not come from the Bible. It did not come from God. Okay? We have decided that it is our authority. Okay? So that is the authority. So there are two authorities. One, the authority of God, which is to keep the Sabbath holy, and the other one is the authority of this power. That's the mark of authority, okay? So I'm going to go to, you have a music that you can play a little bit while I'm going to change my view here, okay? Because we're going to continue on, but, okay, I'm going to go to... Okay, fine. Okay, we're talking about the authority, okay? The authority of God was placed in the law of God, okay? He placed here what His will is. Remember, God said, not everyone that worship me, not everyone that comes to me and called me Lord, Lord, not everyone. You can go to church every day if you want, okay? But God is not going to save you because of that, okay? Or just because you are good, because God said that there are people, there are pagans who don't believe in God, but they are good. When their children ask for bread, they don't give them a serpent, okay? They are kind to other people, they are kind to society, they give a lot of donation, charity, but it doesn't mean that God is going to take them to heaven. God said only those who do the will of God, okay? So the will of God is found in the Old Testament, okay? What's the will of God? Do not worship any other God before me. I am a living God, okay? Do not make unto thee any graven image of anything, of any likeness, somebody that looks like somebody in heaven, somebody that looks like on earth or under the earth, okay? Do not bow down to them, do not worship them or serve them, because I am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers to their children from the second, third, and fourth generation, okay? To them that does not worship me. And also, the third one is, do not call the name of God in vain, okay? The calling the name in vain, that is also a mistake of so many people, even Christians. Whenever they are mad, oh God, oh my God, they use the name of God every time they have to blame somebody or to curse or to blame themselves for doing some mistake. No, okay? You cannot blame God for that, okay? You can say, oh my gosh, maybe not even that. Maybe say, oh, why did I make that mistake? But don't call God every time you make a mistake. And the fourth commandment is, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Like I mentioned also, that because he's the creator of the heaven and earth, that is his authority, the Sabbath. That is the love of God, love to God, that the first four. And the next, the 5 to 10 is the love to man. If you love your fellow man, he said, honor your parents, okay? Do not kill, do not commit adultery, do not steal, do not bear false witness against your neighbor, and do not covet, okay? And some people say, you know what I have here in my background here? This just reminds me. When I went to Mindanao one time, okay? I preached there. I hung this on the wall. The law of God according to the Old Testament and the law of God according to the New Testament. And the law of God has changed by that authority on earth, okay, which is the papacy. Anyway, there were some people who, without even listening to the rest of the sermon, they said, I would like to join, I would like to be baptized. And you know what? I asked them, why? You are not even finished, you make the decision already. Because that when you saw me, when I saw that poster, I have decided to obey God. Because he said, I've been in a church for many years already, because he's already maybe in his 50s or 60s. I've been in church all the time, and I was told that the Ten Commandments is not in the New Testament, it's only in the Old Testament. Well, I said, I'm sorry to tell you that every text is there. It talks about the first commandment of worshiping God alone. It talks about worshiping idols. It talks about Sabbath. It talks about all the 10 are all in the New Testament. The only reason why you didn't find it is because you did not study the Bible yourself. You just allowed somebody to study it and tell you about it, and you just accept what they said to you. Okay? But it's all there. So when he saw this, that it's all there in the New Testament, he had been told from birth, or from when he started going to church, that God's law is not in the New Testament. He was disappointed that he was told that, okay? Because he was going to be deceived. He was not going to make it to eternal life. But he said, I'm going to accept that now because I saw it. And he looked at his Bible. They're all in this Bible. And this is how it looks like. According to, you know why it became 10 again? Because in the new version, Okay? And the new version, we trust the authority of man, not the authority of God. The do not make graven images was removed. So there's no, so the second commandment, not to make graven images, was removed. That's why many people in this world, they worship graven images, okay? And in order to make it 10 again, they divided it two. Thou shalt not covet, according to God's commandment, thou shalt not covet. They made it two there. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's wife, and then thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's good. Why do you have to separate it? It's all it's the same. I mean, thou, if you covet, could be anybody, neighbor, wife, or goods, whatever, okay? So, on what day, but let us look at the, Jesus said, the authority of him is to worship on the Sabbath. So, if we are all obeying God, if Jesus is the head of our church, okay, so we have to follow the head. Because I was talking to somebody, he said, I asked him, who is the head of your church? He said, the head of our church is Jesus Christ. Is that true? So, what do you do if the head of your church is Jesus Christ? Well, we obey, don't you think you should follow his steps? I said, yes. Okay, so tomorrow, let's say that today is Saturday. Jesus said, okay, let's go to church, let's convene, let's get together to worship. And you're going to say, oh no, because my worship day is tomorrow. So whose head are you following? Is it Jesus? He was not able to say anything. Let us look at the lifestyle of Jesus. And he came to Nazareth where he was brought up, and as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on a Sabbath day and stood up to read. So it was the custom. When it's a custom, it's a lifestyle. It's something that he was trained for from childhood, to go to church every Sabbath. The seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. Okay? So when the Sabbath was passed, very early in the morning, the first day of the week, they came unto the sepulchre. Remember the story of Jesus one day, when he died, okay? He died on a Friday, and he did not want to have any commotion Saturday. He stayed in his tomb, and he rose up on a Sunday, okay? And then, in the beginning, God created heaven and the earth, and on the seventh day, God ended his work, and he did three things. He rested, not because he was tired. He rested to stop him from his daily work. He blessed the day and he made it holy. He did not do that to the other days of the week. He only did that on a Sabbath, on a seventh day. And I'm happy that he only did it on one day, because if he made all the days holy, we will not have time to work for our existence anymore on earth, okay? So, because a day, when it's holy, it's only for God, okay? The time is supposed to be for God. God made the Sabbath at the time of creation, when he made the world, he rested on the seventh day and blessed and sacrificed it. Some people say that the Sabbath is only for the Jews, okay? Let me ask you, my friends, was there any Jew in existence at the time when creation was done by God? Was Adam a Jew? Was Eve a Jew? No. There were only two people. It was given by God. That commandment was given by God. There was no Jew at all. We did not even know if there's going to be any Jew at all. Okay, the Jews only came several thousand years after that, before the Jew existed. Okay, anyway, what does God say about the Sabbath and keeping the Ten Commandments which he has wrote? Remember the Sabbath day, he said, to keep it holy. You should not do any work that day. The time is for me, your son, your daughter, your servants, your cattle, a stranger that is within your gates, because God made that day holy. That's what he said. And, you know, of all the Bible, God did not write anything. The only participation that God made in the Bible was to write the Ten Commandments. So the Ten Commandments is something that has to last forever. It's very important. We cannot ignore it and say that it's not good anymore. Because if you look at the Bible, Deuteronomy 9:10 says that the Ten Commandments was written by God with his own finger. See? Moses did not see God writing it, but he saw the finger of God. He showed his finger writing it. I know in the movie it was fire, but that doesn't say according to the translation of the movie, but it was God's finger who wrote the Ten Commandments. Haven't the Ten Commandments been changed? Jesus said, it will be easier for heaven and earth to pass than one title of the law to fail. Okay? What God said, whatever comes out of my mouth will not come back void. And the 10 commandments came out of his mouth. My covenant will I not break, nor alter the thing that is gone out of my lips. Whatever come out of Jesus, of God's lips, is not going to be altered, okay? He's not like us who make mistake, he write something, and then, oh, it's a mistake, I change it. No, he does not change whatever come out of his mouth. The 10 commandments came from the lips of God. And God spake all these words, saying, the 10 commandments follow the verses. Indeed, it is utterly impossible for any of God's moral law ever to change. Okay? The commandments are binding today and forever. Did the apostles keep the Sabbath? And Paul, as his manner was, also the manner of Paul after he was converted, he went unto them, and three Sabbaths they reasoned with them out of the scriptures. So Paul reasoned with the people. He goes to church every Sabbath. Okay? And Paul reasoned in the synagogue. They said it's only for the Jews. How come Paul preached not only to the Jews, but he also preached to the Greeks? Okay? So it was for everyone. Okay? The Gentiles also worship on the Sabbath. Blessed is the man that keepeth the Sabbath from polluting it. The sons and daughters that join themselves to the Lord, everyone that keepeth the Sabbath from polluting it and taketh hold of my covenant. Even them will I bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of worship, of prayer, for my house shall be called a house of prayer for all people. He wants people to open a church on a Sabbath and make that church a house of prayer every Sabbath. Okay? The apostles, when the Jews were gone out of the synagogue, the Gentiles besought the words, because the Gentiles were taught about the Sabbath. So it's not only for the Jews, it was taught to the Gentiles. And the next Sabbath day came almost the whole city together to hear the word of God. That's at the time of disciples. And he reasoned in the synagogue every Sabbath and persuaded the Jews and the Greeks. That's apostle. The apostle in the early New Testament church not only obeyed God's Sabbath commandment, but they also taught the converted Gentiles to worship on a Sabbath. Never once do they refer to Sunday as a holy day. Never. As a matter of fact, I investigated it because I was called to do a Bible study one time with somebody. A couple called me to, a husband called me to give them a Bible study. I went to their house. And the wife was blaming the husband. The wife said, why did you call him to do a Bible study? Don't you know, I told you already, I used to teach theology at the University of Santo Tomas in the Philippines. She was a teacher, theology teacher, she said, okay? And I taught for 20 years I've been teaching before they came to Canada. And I've taught many people who became priests and became nuns, she said. Okay, so I know the Bible. So we do not need a Bible study. And so I said, well, probably not. Okay, but so because you have been teaching Bible for many years, more than what I've been, more than me teaching the Bible, maybe we can compare notes. Maybe I can learn from you. So we sat down and studied. When we came to the subject of the Sabbath, okay, she said that it was already changed to Sunday worship. I asked her, could you please prove it in the Bible, show me that it was changed, transferred to Sunday. So we went over the different texts in the Bible, because there's also in the Bible about the first day meeting, first day gathering. Every time she comes up with a text, I said, so where does it say that God changed the Sabbath to Sunday? What does it say? Eventually, she gave up. She said, I'm sorry. Okay? It's not in the Bible that it was changed to Sunday. No, she said. So I said, where do you base your belief? Why you're keeping a different day? She said, you know, we do not base our belief on the Bible alone. Well, when we started, you said sola scriptura, Bible alone. Now you don't want to do it from the Bible alone. You know what she said? Where do you base your belief? She said, we base our belief, one on tradition, and the other one is on inspiration, and the other one is on the Bible. So three sources of belief. So I asked her, supposing your tradition is teaching you something that is not in the Bible. Well, we accept that if it makes sense, she said. supposing your inspiration, the one inspiring you, is not God or is spirit, it's not, it's his enemy, it's Satan's enemy, or Satan's angel or spirit that's teaching you. So how do you know if it's correct, it's right or wrong? She was not able to say anything. Because you don't know. That's why the Bible says you have to test every teaching, test every spirit. If it is not done here, it's not from God. Okay? And then she just said, I'm sorry. You know, like I said already, the people who do not want to change, they will not change from where they are. That's why God said they're going to die in their sin, wherever they are. Because he said, let us stop the Bible study now. So I cannot force her. That's her decision. Okay? That's why God said, do not waste my word, do not waste my jewels to the dogs and the pigs. Because he said, because they will just trample it under their feet and they will tear you apart. Okay, so I don't want to be torn apart, or I don't want God's word to be wasted. So I accepted the challenge. But here are all the texts. If you would like, I can email it. Send your email to my email to you. All the texts that talks about the first day worship, the first day gathering, there I have all the texts for them. Where people met and gathered on the first day of the week, they're all here. There are only 9 texts, okay? 9 texts in the Bible about people. Like when Paul told the people to meet so he can bring some good for the other church. They did, or first day of the week, that's fine. But it did not say that the first day of the week was made holy or it replaced the Sabbath. And there are only, as I found in the Bible, you might find more, but I found in the Bible 9 texts that talks about meeting on a first day of the week. But I never found a text which says that it was changed to Sunday, okay? So it's positive that Sunday sacredness had no place. The conclusion, that the Sunday worship had no place whatsoever in the example of teachings of Jesus Christ, okay? The Sunday observance showed that without one particle of scriptural foundation, okay, and so on, the only safe position is to stand where Jesus stands. Okay, let me show you what happened. There are 40 verses about the Sabbath in the Old Testament, okay, about keeping the Sabbath holy. And there are 59 verses in the New Testament, okay, 6 Bible verses about keeping the Sabbath, 27 about Sabbath and Christ, 8 verses, okay. So they all talk about the Sabbath, most of them. And here it says here, the Sabbath day, Sunday, according to the Bible, okay, it says here, amazing. In the New Testament, okay, it has said that that were okay, Bible verses. It says here somewhere that there were 59 a Sabbath Saturday worship in the Bible. Christian Ten Commandments. Sabbath mentioned 59 times. Okay, the Sabbath worship. There were 9 gatherings mentioned of first day worship, but. In the New Testament, there were 59 times. And yet people say that the Sabbath keeping is not in the New Testament. It has more texts about the Sabbath keeping in the New Testament than there was about the first day, which is 9 day, which they only met because they have to do something, but not to worship, okay? Maybe it could be to worship, but you can worship any day. You can worship God Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. But it is not the day that was made by God to be holy, okay? Okay, there was the Sabbath change to Sunday at Christ's death. Was it changed? No, there is not this remotest hint that the Sabbath was changed at Christ's death or resurrection. The Bible teaches the opposite. God blessed the Sabbath, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, okay? Christ expected the people to still be keeping the Sabbath 70 years. In AD 70, when Jerusalem was destroyed, knowing that it will be destroyed by Rome in AD 70, Jesus warned his followers before he even left for heaven, pray that your flight to run away will not be on the winter, neither ought be on the Sabbath. So they prayed, and their prayer was answered. It happened not on a Sabbath, on a different day of the week. Wasn't the Sabbath changed to Sunday at Christ's death and resurrection? If you look at it, the day before the Sabbath, the women came to anoint Jesus' dead body and keep the Sabbath, the day before the Sabbath, okay? They called it Friday. The women prepared spices, but they rested the Sabbath according to the commandments, okay? So even the women obeyed the commandments of God. Only when the Sabbath was passed did the women come the first day of the week. To continue the Sabbath work, they found Jesus was risen early in the first day of the week, called the Easter Sunday. Please note that the Sabbath, according to the commandment, was day preceding Easter Sunday, which is now called Saturday, okay? Christ's followers wrote two books, and the book of Luke and Acts. It says that the book of Luke, he wrote about all of Jesus' teachings, but he never wrote about Sunday keeping or change to the Sabbath, of the Sabbath. Some people say that Sabbath will be kept in God's new earth. It says in the Bible, Isaiah 66:22, it shall come to pass that from one new moon to another, and from one Sabbath to another, shall all flesh come to worship before me, said the Lord, every Sabbath. So, if you do not want to go to heaven, that's fine. You can keep whatever day. You can keep Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, holy, if you like. If you don't believe in Jesus, that's fine, okay? But if you believe in Jesus, if you believe the Bible, if you believe the teachings of Jesus, we have to train keeping the Sabbath, the seventh-day Sabbath, which is Saturday holy, because that will be the practice in heaven, okay? Because otherwise, maybe Jesus might not invite you to go to heaven, because what will be happened? They'll be calling for worship, and you don't want to go because you're waiting for the next day. No, it will be kept in heaven, not even by all flesh will worship him every Sabbath, not only heaven, but even the new earth. That is what he said, okay? So he will not change it. That's why he trains us to obey him even right on earth. The Bible says that the saved people of all ages will keep the Sabbath in the new earth, okay? So if you want to be saved, if you want eternal life, you gotta learn how to keep the Sabbath. Call the Sabbath a delight, the holy of the Lord, for the Son of Man is the Lord of the Sabbath, okay? Should I not keep Sunday in honor of Christ's resurrection? Know ye not that so many of us were baptized into Christ's death, were baptized into his death. So when you accept Jesus and you would like your name to be removed from the book of death to the book of life, then that is why it is being immersion in the water and coming out. The death of Christ is being symbolized in the baptism. Okay, you die and you rise up to the new life. That is how you celebrate the resurrection of Christ, through your baptism, not through keeping it holy, because it is only symbolized in the baptism. That's how you celebrate the resurrection of Christ, through the celebration. No, the Bible never suggests Sunday keeping in honor of his death, burial, and resurrection. But it is through this baptism only, okay? Okay, and if Sunday keeping is not in the Bible, whose idea was it anyway? It was already prophesied in Daniel 7:25. Remember I mentioned to you that God gave Daniel a vision of what will happen at the end? It was prophesied there that there will come a time when somebody, if you like, let us read Daniel 7:25, because you will see it there. Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Daniel 7:25. It, because it was prophesied there already. Okay, Daniel 7:25. Let me read it to you. It says here in Daniel 7:25. Okay, there will come a time that somebody will come out and speak pompous words against the Most High, and they shall persecute the saints of the Most High, and they shall intend to change the times and law. Then the saints that shall be given unto them in hand for a time and two times and half a time. So it was prophesied that there will be a big power on this earth that will change God's law and God's time. And let me see how this happened. The commandment of God is not in effect by your tradition. In vain they worship me, teaching the doctrines and commandments of man. That's why God Christ mentioned that you are obeying me through your tradition, not through my commandments. And also you're obeying the commandments of man, not commandment of your creator. So he said, her priests have violated my law, that in Ezekiel 22:20-28. And her prophets have doubted them which untampered mortal, saying, thus said the Lord. There are pastors, priests, and ministers, according to the Bible, who say this is what God said, but God never said it. And the reason why you obeyed and you did not know is because you just obeyed the priest instead of the Bible, okay? You did not read your Bible yourself, see? And that many things. God said it when he did not say it, okay? Misguided men of long years past announced that God's holy day was changed from Sabbath to Sunday. God predicted it would happen, and it did. This error was passed on to our unsuspecting generation as gospel fact. Sunday keeping is a tradition of uninspired men and breaks God's law, which commands Sabbath keeping. Only God can make a day holy. God bless the Sabbath, and when the God bless, no man can reverse it. Okay? It is Sabbath that God blessed, no other day. He made it holy. Isn't it very dangerous to tamper with God's law? According to Deuteronomy 4:2, ye shall not add unto my word which I command you, neither shall you diminish aught from it, that ye may keep the commandments of the Lord your God. Okay? Why? Because he said, it is a sign of creation, my creation. Remember the Sabbath day. I was the one who created the heavens and the earth. And I rested and I made it holy. That's what God said. It is a sign of redemption also. Moreover, also I gave my Sabbath to be a sign between me and them, that they might know that I am the Lord that sanctified them. So if you're a Saturday Sabbath keeper, it's like carrying a sign that I am a follower of Jesus Christ. Okay? I obey Jesus, okay? Now, so how was this fulfilled? The sign, the Sabbath was changed to Sunday, it was fulfilled. That prophecy in Daniel 7:25 was fulfilled. Because the Sabbath was changed to Sunday, okay, by some power on earth. And, but it's very dangerous because God said, sin is transgression if we break God's law. And if for those who follow breaking God's law, that is sin. That's why Jesus said, if you do not want to change, you're going to die in your sin. Because if you are a Monday keeper, Tuesday keeper, or not a Saturday keeper, you're going to believe that, you will accept that even in your work, and you're going to die in that belief. So you're going to die in sin, and when you die, your probation is closed because you cannot change anymore, because you will die being Monday, Sunday, or whatever day keeper. Is not from God. Whosoever shall keep the whole law and offend in one point, he's guilty of all. James 2:10. Christ suffered for our sin, leaving us an example that he should follow his steps. He became the author of eternal salvation unto all them that obey. Okay? So, the law, the Ten Commandments is like the law of 10 chains. How many chains do you have to break? You break one, you break all. Because the Ten Commandments connect us. If God is holding the other end of the 10 chain, and you're holding on the other end, how many do you have to break? You break one chain and you're disconnected from God. It's a matter of life and death. Sabbath keeping is enjoined in the fourth commandment. The deliberate breaking of any one of commandments of God is a sin. Christians will gladly follow Christ's example, Sabbath keeping. Our only safety is diligently to study the Bible, rightly dividing the word of truth. We must have positive scripture support in order to practice any belief. Okay? Her priests have violated my law and have profaned my holy things. They have put no difference between the holy and profane and have hidden their eyes from my Sabbath. I am profane among them. Therefore have I poured out my indignation upon them. It's very dangerous for those leaders who are teaching that Saturday Sabbath is not holy, because God already made a pronouncement that he will pour out indignation toward them. Okay? So, this coronavirus, I believe, is a time to warn everybody or to remind everybody that God is the authority on earth as well as in heaven. In hiding their eyes from God through Sabbath, religious leaders offend the God of heaven. God promises punishment for such false teachers and shepherds. Millions have been misled in this matter. God cannot treat it lightly. Jesus condemned the Pharisees for pretending to love God while making void one of his 10 commandments by their tradition.
So Jesus is very was straight on this, okay? He really talked about this when he was on earth. If you love me, keep my commandment. John 14:15, that's what Jesus said. So so then every one of us shall give account of himself. Romans 14:12 says, therefore to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. Blessed are they that do his commandment, that they may have the right to the tree of life. They were also promised. Commandment keepers were promised that they will enter heaven. They will enter through the gates of the city. And Revelation 22:14, it says, here are the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God. It was shown to the prophet and vision. Who are those people who are going to enter God's heavenly kingdom? According to the Bible, they are God's commandment-keeping people. Okay? And the manner of keeping the Sabbath, we were even taught how to keep the Sabbath. The day before the Sabbath, 7th day of the week, that's called Preparation Day. We also noticed that the day was made holy. We are commanded to keep it holy. To keep it holy, on a Sabbath day, we are not to pollute, desecrate the Sabbath by what we do or think. Trembling that day, treating it as an ordinary day is not good. Doing our own pleasure, going our own way, speaking our own words. The day is the Lord's day, and our own minds should be directed from self to God. So that this day we go to church. It was a command, Leviticus 23:3. It is the day that we should congregate together in church. Of course, we cannot do that now because of this lockdown, which was an order from the government, which also to protect ourselves, does not contradict God. That's why we are worshiping even in our own homes, okay? Nothing for self that we can do in the 6 other days that we cannot, we have to do in the Sabbath. And except to meet and fellowship with fellow believers, assemble with them. We are not to talk and provoke, we are to talk and provoke one with another in the service of love, pleasing. We must be sure that our hearts are clean. That's why on a preparation day, we should ask for forgiveness, whatever sin we have done day, to enter the Sabbath holy. Sabbath begins sundown Friday and ends on sundown Saturday, okay? Those things we need to observe, okay? We need to buy, we need to prepare the things that we need to prepare. Do your groceries, clean your house if you have to do cleaning. Do it before the Sabbath, before the preparation day. As a matter of fact, I told my wife, go to the groceries on Thursday, because if you do it on Friday, sometimes there's a rush there, there's a crowd in the grocery stores, and then you are breaking the Sabbath because you still be shopping and it's already evening, okay? Because Sabbath starts from sundown. That's why you look at the Jews. 3 o'clock in the afternoon, they already closed their stores and businesses because they have to keep the Sabbath. Emergency work that is needed to save the life of someone could be done. Like if somebody is sick, you can visit that on the Sabbath. You can do work of compassion. You can teach the Bible, whatever. Only the Lord can make you holy. Keeping the Sabbath makes you realize. Keeping the Sabbath assures you that God has made you holy and accept you as his child. Okay? So, some people say, has the world not been confused about the Sabbath? Never was there any confusion, because before, if you look at the Genesis, there were no names on the week. There's no names on the days of the week. There's no Sunday, Monday, Tuesday. First day was called first day, second day, third day, okay? But then when they started giving names on the days, the first was given by the Latin names. First day was called Gesloni, okay? And then when they translated to Saxon, Sunday, Monday, and then eventually it was translated to English. So the days were the same. And if the counting was wrong, Jesus would have corrected it. Only 2,000 years ago, he was alive there in Jerusalem. Okay? He would have said, you're keeping the wrong day now. Now it's still the same. That's why millions of people, millions of Jews are still keeping the same day that Jesus kept when he was on earth. Okay? I gave them a Sabbath to be a sign between me and them, that they might know that I am the Lord that sanctified them. It is a sign between us, created beings, and our God, that we receive Him, we accept Him as our Lord and Savior. God gave us a sign, a glorious sign of His power to create and His power to sanctify, and He gave us a seal, sign, and mark, token, interchangeably, God's sign, Sabbath, represents His holy power to rule us as our Creator and our Savior. Revelation says, it will be written upon the foreheads of His people. It will signify that they are owned by God and have His sign, okay? His name sealed on it, okay? That's why He said, I'll put a sign in your head and in your hand, okay? And He said, true Sabbath keeping signifies that a person has surrendered his life to Jesus Christ and is willing to follow Jesus. Now, let me just show you what different people have said about the keeping of, by changing the Sabbath to Sunday. From the Catholic Catechism, you can read, have you any other way of proving that the Church has power to institute festivals and precepts? Okay? He said, had she not such power, she could not have done that which is all modern religionists agree with her. She could have not substituted the observance of Sunday, the first day of the week, for the observance of Saturday, the seventh day of the week, change for which there is no scriptural authority. See, read that. There is no scriptural authority. The change was done with no scriptural authority. Okay? The papacy here is saying that it changed Sabbath to Sunday and that virtually all churches accepted the new holiday. The papacy claims that Sunday is a holiday, a symbol of her mark and symbol of her power and authority. Okay? So the reason why the rest of the world worship on a Sunday is because they recognize the power of the papacy. That's fine, okay? I'm not criticizing anybody, whether worship Saturday or Sunday, it's up to you, it's what you believe. We are still observing, we still have religious freedom to be able to obey God or to obey God, worship God according to the dictates of our minds, okay? So, maybe there's reason. There's a reason why the papacy changed it to Sunday, and he has probably good reasons about it. And God also has good reasons for saying that it remained to be Sabbath. They both have good reasons. It is us who have to decide. So if you think that the reason of God for saying that is a good reason, that we obey Sabbath, that's fine. That's your decision. Okay? If you think that the decision of the papacy is better for changing it to Sunday, it's more convenient for us to worship, to go to church. More people are doing it, okay? Because it's not, the Bible says not always the majority that is right. But if you think that is what you should follow, you'd follow. Remember, you build your own monument or you dig your own pit. You decide for your eternal destiny of your life. You either receive everlasting life or everlasting death. So it's all based on us and what we choose. Okay? The papas changed her laws. Her catechism, she has omitted the second commandment against the veneration of images. Okay, some changes. Shortened the fourth commandment to just a few words. Remember the Sabbath and so on. And another change that was done was also the change of time. Remember, she also remembered God's law will be changed by a power, and also that will a commandment which will involve the law, which is the Sabbath law, and also the time. How was the time changed? Remember, according to God, the day changes from sunset to sunset. So sunset, so to at about 5-6 o'clock when the sun sets, it's already Sunday. While they also made a change according to the power of this earth, they made a change. It's from midnight to midnight. That's why I know some friends who said, I am a Sabbath keeper already. Why? He said, I go to church 5-6 o'clock in the evening. Okay? And that is still on Saturday. So I told her, okay, that is not a Saturday, that's Sunday already. You go to church on a Sunday because the change of days, according to God, is sunset to sunset. Okay? But that change was done in order, because that is also to confuse, done to confuse people. Because if you go to church in the evening, you still think it's Saturday according to the tradition, which is midnight to midnight. But on God's authority, it is already a different day. So which do you want to follow? The authority of God or authority of someone who does not want to follow God's authority? Which is the Sabbath day according to the Catholic Catechism? Saturday is the Sabbath day according to them. Okay? Why do we observe Sunday? We observe Sunday instead of Saturday because the Catholic Church transferred the solemnity from Saturday to Sunday. Okay? They said, the Church is above the Bible, and this transference of Sabbath observance from Saturday to Sunday is a proof positive of that fact. The papacy is saying that it is successful. The successful change of Sabbath observance to Sunday worship is a proof that it is it has a greater authority. Okay? That's fine. God warned religious leaders against causing people to stumble by saying, giving commandments that God did not teach. God warned people who want their ministers to preach smooth fables rather than the truth about His law. Okay? God warned people about hardening of their hearts against the truth of His law. God warned people who say it would seem strange to keep God's law, like the Sabbath example. God states that upheaval, tragedy, problems, and woes of this earth come because people refuse to follow His law and have even tried to change it. God solemnly warned that leaders who teach there is really no difference between sacred things, such as God's holy Sabbath, and common things, such as Sunday, will face indignation. Those are the warnings from God. The forehead represents the mind. The hand represents the work. That's why God, eventually, when He divides the people of this world into two camps, we will be seen depending on our sign, what we believe and what we practice. For either the sign or mark, for either God or for the beast, will be invisible, but it will be seen through our works. You will see, in essence, mark yourself by accepting either God's sign or mark, the Sabbath, or the beast sign, Sunday. Though invisible to man, God will know who has which mark. Okay? God will know that. Cry aloud, spare not, lift up the voice like a trumpet, and show my people their transgression. Okay? That's why we're crying aloud. Okay, the internet would have stopped it this morning, but we're crying aloud. If thou turn away thy foot from the Sabbath, from doing thy pleasure on my holy day, and call the Sabbath a delight, then shall I delight, shall thou delight thyself in the Lord. He says, my people, Jesus said, my people, that they are innocently sinning because they are trampling on my holy day, and ask them to quit breaking my Sabbath so I can bless them. So this is an announcement to you people who are not keeping God's Sabbath day holy. Amen. You are breaking God's law innocently, but God said still you are sinning. The message is too important to treat as ordinary. It is a life or death issue. Jesus says His sheep or people will follow Him when He calls. That's why no one will have the mark or beast until Sunday worship comes. There's a question. Will somebody have the mark of the beast already now? No one will have that yet. That will be given when there will be a division of God's followers and those who do not want to follow God. At that time, okay, when Sunday worship becomes an issue forced by the law, okay, when Sunday worship becomes an issue that will be forced by the law, at that time, those who decide to follow the false teachings of the beast and worship on Sunday, counterfeit holiday, will receive the mark of the beast. Those who follow Jesus, will obey His truth, will keep His Sabbath day holy, they will receive also the mark of God's followers. Okay, so the mark will be given, the sign will be given. That is why God will start to close the probation, even at the process of closing the probation, because on that day it will be sealed. God, remember, God said that in the end He will say, those who are with me, they will be with me, and those who are not with me, they will stay where they are. Those who expect to refuse the beast mark in the future must step under Jesus' Sabbath banner now. His power is available to all those who obey Him. Without Him, we can do nothing. With Him, all things are possible. Those who have God's mark or Sabbath in their foreheads, they will be recognized by God. those who refuse to identify with the beast or its image and who refuse to have this mark in the name in their foreheads, those people who today and for eternity follow where Jesus leads, trusting him fully in everything. There is no other way. Okay, if you want to have eternal life, that's the only way. What is Jesus saying to people today? He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. Okay, what a fantastic promise. If we follow him, we will not end in darkness. Okay? And he said also, he will also say, this covenant put mark in the foreheads. And that said that in Revelation, the seven last plagues will fall upon the disobedient. That's in Revelation 16. If you read Revelation 16, it will tell you about the seven last plagues. And that will only fall on those people who do not join God's come under his banner. It also marks us as ready for translation in Jesus' second coming. So you make the decision. If on the seven last plagues you suffer, you know you're already marked, you're destined already for everlasting death, the fire, according to the Bible. What blessed protection. He gives us warning. He gives us warning, just like what Noah did. He gave warning for 100 years to people to change, to listen to God and obey God. And they didn't listen, so they all drowned. Okay? You will discover some astounding information in the final three in this message, the rule of the United States and the Earth's final conflict, how the churches and religious of all world will be involved, collaborate what would world conditions will precipitate Earth's final battle, Satan's amazing strategy for deceiving billions. Okay, now let me show you that God is right in saying that people die in their sin knowingly. Okay. Because and then they cannot change anymore. Okay, that's why the probation will close on them. This is what different people have said, okay, according to their decision. The Baptist, I'm not talking about all the Baptists because everybody still have a chance to change. But according to the leaders of the Baptist, Dr. Edward T. Hitchcock, there was and is a commandment to keep holy the Sabbath day, but that Sabbath day is not Sunday. This guy admitted that he's keeping Sunday, but it was not the right day. So where is he now? He's probably gone, okay? 1893, he's already dead, he's already gone. So did he die? Not a Sabbath keeper. So the probation was closed on him because he died not obeying God, okay? And the Catholics say, you may read the Bible from Genesis to Revelation and you will not find a single line authorizing the sanctification of Sunday by Cardinal Gibbons, 1880. So where is Cardinal Gibbons? He's already gone, but he died in that belief. So God will be in charge of him. So I'm not going to judge anybody, but see, that's why you could die in your belief and you cannot change anymore. The Church of Christ, okay? He said that Sabbath was made not merely for the Israelites. Okay, it's for everyone. It's evident. It said Sabbath was made for man and not man for the Sabbath. Okay, it was made for us. It didn't say Sabbath was made for the Jews. It's for every man. The Congregationalist, he said that Sunday is not the scriptures and was not by the primitive church called the Sabbath. Okay, and Episcopal believers, they said, Sunday of the Roman calendar, day of the sun, because dedicated to sun worship, okay? So it's not the Sabbath, according to that. The Lutherans say that Lord's Day is founded not in any command of God, but in the authority of the church. That's according to Augsburg Confession of Faith. And then the Methodists take the manner of Sunday. There was no indication in the New Testament as to how the church came to keep the first day week holy day, but there is no passage telling us in the Bible that the transfer was made to Sunday from the Sabbath. Moody said the same thing. The fourth commandment begins with the word remember, showing that Sabbath already existed when God wrote the law in the tables of stone at Sinai. So it didn't start from Sinai, but God said remember. That means he told them before that to always keep the Sabbath holy. Presbyterian, they said that it can be shown that the whole moral law has been revealed The Sabbath will stand. The teaching of Christ confirms perpetuity of the Sabbath. So these are leaders who accepted that. The Pentecostals. Why do we worship on Sunday? Doesn't the Bible teach us that Saturday should be the Lord's Day? Okay, is Sunday the Lord's Day? No, it's Saturday the Lord's Day. Okay, and that's 1959. He's probably gone already, but did he die in that belief? That he's accepting Sunday instead of the truthful Sabbath, which he knows about it? Of course. Everything, okay? We know where the Sunday worship started. It was during the time of the Tower of Babel, when there was Nimrod who rebelled against God. Who will be the Lord's side? The battle of Armageddon is the battle of minds, okay? God's remnant church will be composed of those who refuse the falsehood of Babylon, false of confusion. Though Satan hates God and his son, he rarely admits it openly. In fact, he and his demons will pose as holy angels, as devoted Christian clergymen. What he represents as evidence for his side will seem so righteous, because Satan has spiritual leaders also. Jesus, like nearly everybody on earth, will be deceived and follow him, okay? Because he's got angels, Satan has angels, he's got clergymen, he's got pastors also, who will be teaching, and they will come with the Bible, okay? But if you do not pay attention to the Bible, then deception may come to you. He will doubtless use the Bible as did he when he tempted Jesus. Satan's logic is so persuasive that it deceives one third of the angels of heaven. Adam and Eve at the time, everybody on earth were deceived except 8 people. Remember? It was Noah. Okay, everybody were deceived from Adam and Eve all the way to Noah's time. That's why God eliminated all the people of the earth at that time, but except 8 people, Noah and his wife, and at least he saved his 3 children. But for you parents who are listening, how many of you are going to be able to convince your children about these teachings of God? How many of your children will go with you? That is a big problem also, okay? At least Noah, his children obeyed him, okay? To the law and the testimony, if they speak not according to the word, it is because there is no light in them. Isaiah 20. Please notice that Jesus refers to many people. Jesus said, I have children in other flocks, in other beliefs, okay? And Babylon, who have not heard this urgent warning message. These people love the Lord supremely. They come to church. They go to church every day, maybe every week or every day. And Jesus says to them, so, Jesus said, other ships have I, which are not of this fold, and nothing may come. Them also I must bring, and they shall hear my voice. And there shall be one fold and one shepherd. My sheep will hear my voice, and I know them, and they will follow me. So, Jesus said, I have children in other flocks, but they do not know about me. But when they receive my word, they will recognize it's me talking to them. They will come out from where they are, and they will join my camp. That's why maybe this coronavirus was allowed by God to happen, so that those of you who have not heard about this wonderful message of saving the lost can hear it, and you can decide to stay where you are. But the call of Jesus is that come out of Babylon. Babylon is a word for confusion. Come out of your confusing beliefs, my people. Because you are also God's child, you follow me, you want to obey me, but you do not know the truth. That now that you know the truth, come out from where you are and receive, so that you will not receive the plagues mentioned in Revelation 16. So you will not suffer. For her sins have reached unto heaven, and God hath remembered the iniquities of people. So if you do not like to suffer in that Revelation 16 plague that God is preparing to pour out, indignation to the people who does not want to obey him, then you should come out from where you are. Okay? If you are in Babylon right now, are you willing to hear Jesus' urgent appeal to come out? Are you? This is a question that is being asked of you. Okay? Because time will come. Revelation 21, 11 to 11, he says, He that is unjust, he will pronounce that. He will make this pronouncement also. He that is unjust, let him be unjust. And he which is filthy, let him be filthy still. And he that is righteous, let him be righteous still. And he that is holy, let him be holy still. And then after, he will make that pronouncement. The seven last plagues will come to those who will not be saved. And then he will appear in the clouds of heaven. Okay, so you have the time, if you are listening to this message, you have the time to come out. Come out of false teaching, come out of false belief, and come to the camp of God. Okay, how sure are you that these are true words from God? It's in your Bible, it's in the Bible of people in the whole world. Written before any of those other teachers were born. It was already written by God. Written, translated, given to people through his prophets. And you know why these words will all be fulfilled? Because this word, the Bible, this is the judge. Jesus is not going to judge, does not have to judge anyone anymore at that time. He does not have to say, you are not right according to this book. He will not say that anymore. He doesn't have to say it. He already knows because he's got a book of records. Okay, those names who are not written in the book of life will all go to the book of death. Will all go to with Satan and his angels. That's what he said. And so the Bible is very important because this is the judge. He said, he that rejected me, read that verse there. He that rejected me and received not my words that I have spoken, the same shall be him which is I have spoken, is the same shall judge him in the end. So this is the judge. In the end, all that Jesus will do is say, according to the judge here, according to the word, you did not want to obey. You heard it, but you did not want to believe it. Okay, so the judgment, that's where your judgment is. So this is the judge. Jesus is just going to implement what was written in this book. So let's pay attention to this book, because this is the judge already. And God said, it's evil unto you. Okay? To listen to God, okay? That's Joshua 24, verse 15, okay? Because there are all kinds of teaching, even during the time of Joshua. It seemed evil unto you to serve my living God. But I want you to choose this day whom you will serve. The gods of your fathers which you serve, okay? The God that does not do anything, okay? Maybe that stand up there and do nothing, okay? Or the God on the other side of on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites, in whose land you dwell. But Jesus said, "As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord, the living God." So I have to ask you also this morning: who do you choose to serve? The God of your father, the God of your pastors, the God of your priests or your ministers who taught you things that are not in the Bible, or you would like to serve the God of the Bible that tells you everything that will happen in the Bible? You have to make up your mind. But Joshua said, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. As for my wife and I try to encourage my children, but it's up to them. They have to make up their minds too. As for us, my wife and I, we have decided to go together that we will serve the Lord, okay? If you are in Babylon right now, are you willing to hear Jesus' urgent appeal to you to come out, okay? And according to Isaiah 8:20, if they speak not according to this word, can you read here? If they speak not according to this word, it's because there's no light in them. Can it be read? Okay, so remember that. Galatians 1:8, even if an angel from heaven preached to you any other gospel that is preached unto you, that cannot stand in this Bible. He said, let that angel be cursed, because not an angel of God. Okay? So, if you are willing, remember, the Sabbath day to keep it holy, if you are willing to make a decision, okay, on this, yourself, it's up to you. But the Sabbath worship, the Saturday Sabbath, there is no confusion about it. Because in all the different languages of the world, if you read it, okay, in Belarusian, the Sabbath, the Sabbath, which means Saturday. In all the language of the world, the Sabbath is Saturday, not any other day. The Sabbath is Saturday. Remember, time on earth is short. Probation is closing soon. Prepare to see God face to face by repentance and forsaking of your sins, forsaking of those deceptive beliefs and teachings that you might have acquired, and prepare yourself. Everyone has to make their final decision, truth or tradition. And I'm calling on you, if you are in a place which you do not know any Sabbath keepers out in your place, I'm giving you my email. Email me here. NoelPrias0506@hotmail.com. And I will write you back. I will tell you where to go in order to find people in Jesus' camp who are obeying God's law and God's commandment, who might be able to guide you so you can enlist in the camp of Jesus. Thank you very much. And I hope that all of us have been blessed with a message from God. It's a very strong message. But these are messages that are already been written. Do not hate me if I said something that might have hurt your feelings. I did not stand up here to speak to you to hurt your feelings. I did not intend to do that. Okay? Just hold it. I did not intend to do that. I only am relating to you what the Bible said and what the Bible teaches. And you should, instead of hating me, you should be thankful to me that I have made you aware of these things. Thank you so much. Let us close our eyes. Let us close our eyes and have a, just play the music and a word of prayer. Okay? You want it there? Okay. Let's close our eyes and have a word of prayer as we close. Father God, thank you so much for this very strong, but it's very timely message that we have shared to all the listeners out there today. Thank you, dear Father, for giving me, enabling me, and giving me the privilege to be able to say all these things. I know that I'm just following your will, and you have said, preach the gospel to all nations so that you become a witness, so people can decide, okay? And to all those who believe, to all those who believe, they will be saved, and those who do not believe, they will be damned. I hope, dear Father, that this message today has reached the ears of those who would like to be citizens of your eternal kingdom. Help them, dear Father, they make up their decision so that their decision is for their own good. And whatever they decide, please respect them, dear Father, as you have said. If they decide eternal life, if they decide that it could be whatever, they don't believe you, well, we don't want to force anybody, let it be so. But as we dismiss now, please forgive us our sin. And if I have said anything that is not in accordance to your will, I pray that you will forgive me. Give us now the rest of the day to be able to treat it or spend it in holiness, because this day is holy for you and for everyone of your creation. Forgive us our sins. But please bless us as we separate from each other today, and help us to be able to keep the rest of the day holy. We ask all this favor in Jesus' holy name, I pray. Amen. Yeah.